All right, I want to start off by, because I've thought about what I want to talk about this morning, and it's a compliment to you that I feel I want to go deeper, and I just feel that the morning congregation is the place to share this. All right, if you were asked by God, and you were going to ask him for a special gift, I wonder what it would be. I'm talking spiritual now, okay? I'm not talking about a new husband or a new wife or whatever. I'm talking spiritual. If you were to ask God for a spiritual gift, I wonder what it would be. Let's put aside the gift of salvation. But there are many other things which we could consider. The baptism of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, a God-given ministry, that's just naming a few. Now, I've often shared with you that Psalm 51 has become important to me over the years. In fact, I often refer to it as my Psalm. And in verse 11, David makes it very clear what is important to him. He said, "Do not cast me from your presence or remove your Holy Spirit from me." And many years before that, Moses was talking to God about leading the people of Israel. I'm in Exodus 33. And he said, "If you're pleased with me, teach me your ways, so I may know you and continue to find favor with you. Yeah. Remember that this nation is your people." And the Lord replied, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And Moses said to him, "If your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from you. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth?" You see, Moses knew the importance of God's presence. And he wasn't going to set out on one foot of his journey without having God's presence. Because he knew that it was the one thing that separated him from everybody else. How many of you know that?
Yeah.
God's presence is the one thing that separates you from the world.
Yeah.
And yet, sadly, church, there are many Christians who are completely ignorant of the presence of God. There are many ministers and even pastors who know nothing about the power and the presence of God. And I say to you, anyone who's not experienced the power of God's presence has really got no right to stand and talk about him.
Yeah.
Because such people don't even know him.
That's right.
What they've got is knowledge.
Yeah.
They've gained knowledge from reading books. However, we must never ever take his presence for granted. Having the presence of God with us is worth more than all the riches and all the fame and all the power of this world. We can go anywhere when the presence of God is with us. We don't have to worry about direction if God's presence is with us. In the presence of God, there is fullness of joy. But out of his presence, there is frustration, multiple demons, discouragement, sorrow, fear, sickness, sin, suicide, distress. The secret of success, that's having victory, doing unusual exploits, lies in the fact that God's presence is always with them. Do you want to overcome great problems? Do you want to fulfill your divine destiny? Then you need the power of his presence. Come back into Psalm 51 with me. King David is pleading with God. He's literally saying, you can take anything from me, but don't take your presence away. It's possible for you and I to move out of God's presence. Remember Genesis 4. And Cain went out from the presence of the Lord. Let me remind you what Cain said. My punishment is more than I can bear, being separated from God. Friends, every day we should be down on our faces, pleading with God not to take his presence away from us. Someone once wrote, the closer you are to fire, the hotter it gets. The farther you move away from the fire, the cooler it becomes. And I say to you this morning, the closer that you move to the Lord, the deeper the presence. The farther you move away, the closer you become to the devil. It's a wonderful thing to be in the presence of the Lord, but it's a very dangerous thing to be far away from him. It was jealousy that lost Cain the presence of the Lord, and it was downright sin of disobedience that took Adam and Eve out of God's presence. There was a time with Adam and Eve that they enjoyed the closeness of God, walking in the garden with them. But then they decided to sin, and we're told that they hid themselves from God's presence. And that's what sin does. It hasn't got to be a big sin. A little sin in your life will make you want to hide from God. For the believer, God's presence is not a consideration. It's absolutely essential in our life. Having a sense of God's presence gives you and I a sense of security. It gives us an assurance with God. I have stood on occasions to confront evil spirits. And you know, the knowledge of his presence has added to my power and the thrust of my words, knowing that I had the presence of God. There have been other occasions, and I've stood before a crowd of people who were all expecting to receive from the Lord. And you know, it's been the sense of his presence that has given me the confidence to reach out for more. Some may well say, well, how can I continue on in God's presence? Well, it all depends upon your walk with the Lord. If you're going to daily dwell in the Lord's presence, then your walk has got to be blameless. And by the way, let me talk to you. The background for that word, blameless. In the Old Testament, a worshipper wanted to present a special offering to God. He would find a full-grown ram, one of the prize breeding stock, the very best of the flock, to offer. And he would run his hand and his eye over it to make sure that there were no hidden blemishes. Then he would take it to the priest, who would also give it a careful examination. And then the ram would be slain, And the priest would expose all the inner parts, looking for imperfection. Only a perfect sacrifice was acceptable to the offering for God. It's this process of examination where the word blameless refers. Examinations. If you're going to daily dwell in the reality of the Lord's presence, then you've got to daily examine yourself to make sure that there's nothing in your life that will cause you to be unclean in the sight of God. And as I said, it hasn't got to be big, it can be little. You know, it's my custom, I've just done it, that before we take communion, I always invite believers to examine themselves. Where do I get that from? 1 Corinthians 11. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. I'm going a step further. We must also insist that just as the sacrifice of the Old Testament worshipper was examined not only by the worshipper, but also by the priest, we've got to be very careful not only to look at ourselves, but we need to be asking the great high priest Jesus to also examine our life daily. Psalm 139. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me, know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. But I'm praising God because the analogy between the Old Testament and the New breaks down here. Because the wonderful difference is this. In the Old Testament, an animal would be rejected if it had a blemish. But if you and I discover a blemish within us, we discover we've got a sin. We can still come to our great high priest, and we can still ask him, and he won't reject you. Even if you've got a blemish, he will not reject you. That's the difference. We're under grace. Amen. 1 John 1 verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. There is a member of a major non-Christian religion, and he went up to a missionary who was working in India, and he said, tell me one thing your religion can offer the people of India that mine can't. And the missionary thought for a moment, and he replied, forgiveness. Because unlike the followers of all the other worldly religions, those who put their hope in Jesus Christ have got a full assurance that their sins are forgiven. Amen. Amen? Muslims live in the hope that they might be forgiven. You need to know that you are forgiven. Amen. Equally, if one is to dwell in the Lord's presence, then our words have got to be right. I was reading James. If anyone considers himself to be religious and yet does not keep a tight rein on their tongue, he deceives himself and his religion is worthless. I've not shared this with you before. Don't get angry very often, though. It takes a lot to provoke me. But in my younger days, I can remember that if I allowed my anger to rise up, if I started speaking harsh words, then I would literally feel the Holy Spirit move aside from me I would feel that presence go. He's all powerful, yet he's very sensitive.
Yeah.
You see, there will be no depth of presence if our tongue is not right. And it's the same for the church. If we don't have harmony and unity amongst us, we're going to see his presence diminish. And it's not enough just to tolerate another believer. The command is that we've got to love them. And that means love being expressed by words and deeds. I don't want to keep on about it because I'm there every Tuesday, but unity is the key. If you and I have not got unity, we're not going to see a depth of presence in this church. It's you and I being one in the Lord. Now, the one who walks in the presence of God will also be aware of their motives. They won't be the kind of person who will do anything to get ahead in life. Instead, they will want to be a person of integrity who draws a line when it comes down to how they conduct their life. I was sad the other day. I spoke to a man who was ministering the gospel. And I was absolutely dismayed after we sat down and shared. Because it became apparent to me from his attitude that anything goes as long as you get a result.
Mm-hmm.
The person who is preoccupied with God's presence in their life will be more concerned about their integrity than their image.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
I've got to say this, there was a time when rejection was running in my life, the image to me was everything. No, I don't really care what people think of me. There's only one I'm concerned about. Amen? And his name is Jesus.
Yes.
But I don't go around worrying about what they think or what they think, as long as I'm right with him. Because if I'm right with him, that means I'm probably right with everybody else. Amen? I am more concerned about how God is viewing me. I found a story that sums up what I just shared. After 16 years as a missionary on the continent of Africa, David Livingstone came home to Scotland and he was asked to address the students at Glasgow University. His body had been ravaged by 27 fevers that had overtaken him during his years of service. One arm useless at his side, the result of being mauled by a lion. And do you know what the call of his message was? Shall I tell you what sustained me amidst the toil, the hardship, and the loneliness of my exile? It was Christ's promise. Lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. But you know, Christ's promise is not just for David Livingstone. It's for you and I. God is also obviously with the missionary, but he's also with the Christian living their faith out, or her faith, in a business world, a busy world, in the school, in the home, wherever you are, that promise is there for you. Christ is with every Christian at all times, in all places.
Yeah.
So take courage from that and remain faithful. If you have called upon the name of the Lord and given your heart to Jesus, then you are saved.
Amen.
You are one of God's children. One of the children. In that passage of scripture that I referred to earlier, we're told that God knew Moses by name. Can I remind you God knows you by name.
Hallelujah.
You're not a number on a wall.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
God knows you by name.
Yes.
He knows you're going up, you're coming in. And what's more, as he told Moses, the same is for you and I.
Yes.
God is always looking favorably upon you.
Hallelujah.
And that's why, if I can quote one of the newer translations of the Bible, the Living Translation says this, I will personally go with you.
Amen.
Isn't that lovely?
Yes.
I will personally go with you. Pray continually that we might know his presence as individual believers, but also as a church. Pray that his presence might increase, that it might be manifested through us, that the unbeliever might see and know that God has made such a difference. He set us apart from all the other people on the earth.
Yeah.
Let me ask you a question. Why did God make us? I'll tell you.
Yeah.
God created us to have a relationship.
Yeah.
I think he was lonely. God created you and I to have a relationship. And why does God want to have a close, for you and I to have a close relationship with him? Well, let me explain. God is love. And when you know that love is a reciprocal act, where God loves us and we love him back, that love is called worship. And in order to be loved, love has got to have a recipient. You can't say you love unless you are loving somebody. So God created us that he could pour out his love upon us. So that we in turn could pour out our love back to him. And that's the greatest thing that we can give God, is our love. The Bible says, John 3, for this is the way God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. The Bible reveals to us that God's love for all mankind is an unconditional love. There's no strings attached. Let me give you some Bible scriptures that reveal this truth of God's steadfast, unfailing, eternal love. I'll just go through them. Isaiah 43. You are precious in my sight, and I loved you. 1 John 4. We love him because he first loved us. By nature, you and I were without God. We were afar off from God. We were strangers to God. In fact, we were enemies to God. Therefore, if God had not loved us first, we would have remained forever separated from God.
Right. Thank you.
You see, God loves his people with a free love. I will heal their backsliding, and I will love them freely. Hosea 14. Imagine that. He knows that we're backslidden, yet he says, I will love them freely. God loves his people with an everlasting love. Jeremiah 31. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you. That is, I love you with the love of eternity. Wonderful thought, that. Nothing's going to separate you and I from God. We're going to get to eternity, and that love is going to roll on, isn't it?
Amen.
You see, God loves his people with an unchangeable love. Malachi 3. I am the Lord. I do not change. Men change. Occurrences change. Friends change. Relations change. Governments change. But God never changes. He who is the glory of Israel does not lie or change his mind. For he is not a man that he should change his mind. That's 1 Samuel 15. I love 1 Corinthians 13. 1 Corinthians 13. If I speak in the tongue of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all the mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. No virtue. There's nothing, no gift, no emotion which is greater or more important than love. Don't forget, the brand of love which Paul is talking about is not human in origin. It's a love that comes from God. It's part of God's nature. It's an unselfish, sacrificial, everlasting love. And the Lord wants to transform our character into the image of his Son. And that priority makes perfect sense. Because whenever we display such selfish care for one another, we manifest Jesus' presence and his love. When you pour out your love to someone, then you are manifesting Jesus' presence. Without Christ's love, all our good deeds, even our service to the Lord, they bring nothing, they profit nothing. In God's eyes, a loving and a pure heart is more important than our impressive words, our knowledge, our generosity, or even our self-sacrifice. God looks for love. And when we stand before Christ, and one day we're all going to have to do that, and we're all going to be judged for our good works, those deeds done for selfish reasons won't be worthy of a reward. It'll only be those that are done out of love. All of us are blind to some degree when it comes to our motives. You know, we can be a bit blind when we are thinking of how we're going to serve God or doing good deeds. The psalmist in Psalm 39 said, "Search me, O God, know my heart, test me, know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting." I pray that God will help us to search our hearts, look for any hidden intentions, replace any self-centered motivation with the wonderful, excellent way of Jesus' name. Then we will have works that will last to eternity. I was going to finish there, but I'm not. I'm going to go on. I'm in Exodus 33, just going to read a little bit from there. Moses took his tent and pitched it outside the camp, far from the camp, and called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. And it came to pass that everyone who sought the Lord went out to the Tabernacle of Meeting, which is outside the camp. And so it was, whenever Moses went out to the tabernacle, that all the people rose, and each man stood at his tent door and watched Moses until he had gone into the tabernacle. And it came to pass, when Moses entered the tabernacle, that the pillar of cloud descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle. And the Lord talked with Moses, and all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the tabernacle door. And all the people rose and worshipped, each man in his tent door. So the Lord spoke to Moses face to face, as a man speaks to his friend. And he returned to the camp, but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, did not depart from the tabernacle. Can I suggest what I picked up from reading that passage? Let me finish with some suggestions to you. Are you prepared to leave your camp? Because if you want to draw near to God, you're going to have a willingness to leave the things of the world behind. Amen? If you want the fullness of God's presence, that's going to be a challenge to you. Because so many want God, but they want to hold on to all of the world as well. You can't have it. Secondly, be prepared to spend time with God. Be like Moses, have a tent meeting. Find a place where you can commune with God. I've got my secret place, but every believer should have a secret place where they can spend time with God. And the command, be still and know that I am God, will become increasingly more important if you want to be in his presence. Yeah. Be still and know. Know God. Be prepared to pray. And listen, I'm not talking about sitting down and having 5 minutes of quick prayer. Because really praying means you're listening to God as well as speaking. You're not just rattling off a list of things that you want. It's being still and being in his presence. Tell me, what made Moses different from the people? Listen to that account I just read.
Yeah.
They didn't go near him. They all watched him, but they didn't participate. Each and every one of us, I know you're in church, but each and every one of us, as individual believers, we need to develop our own relationship with God and not be dependent on someone else doing it.
Yeah.
I know some people come to the prayer meeting because they enjoy being under the presence of God. But really, each and every one of us should be developing our own time with God and having that presence. And notice, when he came, Moses came down, that they worshipped from a distance. They were frightened to get too close to God. Well, I don't know about you, but I want to get as close as I can get.
Amen?
And it's going to cost. I am fully aware that if I want to get close to Jesus, then it's going to cost.
Yeah.
He's already paid the price, but it's going to cost me. Because I'm going to have to give up this, and I'm going to have to change that.
Yeah.
It's going to cost.
Yeah, right.
You can't have both. I wrote down here, they were more comfortable by their tents than in the tent of God. You see, their tents represented their lifestyle. You and I need to be careful that we're more concerned about our lifestyle and meeting with God. Friends, we need to be like Moses. We need to get that promise of God from Exodus. My presence will go with you and I'll give you rest. We need that presence. We desperately need it as a church, because out of that presence will come power. And out of that power, we'll see miracles. And then the unbelieving might start believing.
Yeah.
Amen? Amen. Let's praise the Lord. That's an interesting one, the Father's Children finish. Down in the valley. Oh, you might know it. Follow, follow. I will follow.